You see, it's going to pull the sperm cells from the epididymis, move up the spermatic cord.
Today we're going to talk about birth control for men. Now this procedure we're going to discuss, called a vasectomy, makes it so sperm cells can't leave the male reproductive tract and therefore fertilize an egg. But what happens to all the sperm cells that are produced after the procedure is done? I think that's a reasonable question, especially if you watched our last video on sperm production where we learned the testes produce millions of sperm cells per day. So we're going to address that. We'll talk about how the procedure is done, discuss the pros and cons of this form of birth control, and even, can this be reversed? So, to the cadavers. So the exact details of sperm production were discussed in one of our previous videos, which we'll definitely provide a link to that video. However, we're going to pull some highlights from that are relevant to today's discussion. So let's take a look at the right side of the cadaver, specifically the right side of the groin here. And the first structure I want to highlight is the spermatic cord. It's going up towards the abdomen, or if we go downward, that's going to take us to the right testis or right testicle. Now inside of the spermatic cord, we've got blood vessels like veins and arteries for blood supply to and from the testes, also nerves for sensation and controlling muscular tissue, but also a really important tube that's going to transport sperm cells away from the testes. Now, if I reflect this, I'm going to pull the testis out of the scrotal sac, you can see we've still got the connective tissue surrounding the actual testis, but if I turn it over, you can see we've reflected that tissue away, and here is the right testis. Now, on top of the right testis is a structure here called the epididymis. Now, epa means upon, didymis means testis, so a great name for a structure that's sitting on top of the testis. But if we were to go inside of this epididymis, we'd see a highly coiled tube just coiled up in there. But if you were to straighten that out, it would be 20 feet long. Now, what's going on inside of the epididymis? Well, this is where sperm cells mature and where they actually are stored. So with 20 feet of a tube there, plenty of storage space. So what happens when the sperm cells are pulled out of storage, or in other words, called upon? Well, in that case, they're gonna leave this structure called the epididymis, or our little storage facility here, and move into another tube called the vas deferens, also known as the ductus deferens. Either name's appropriate. But this vas deferens is the important tube of our story here, and it's about 18 inches long. That's quite the remarkable length for a tube that's transporting sperm cells. But when we talk about the pathway that it has to travel, it makes a little bit more sense. You see, it's gonna pull the sperm cells from the epididymis, move up the spermatic cord, and enter through a canal in the abdominal wall to go back inside the pelvic cavity, wrap around the backside of the bladder, and enter into the prostate gland to eventually meet up with the urethra. It's quite the length. Now, we can see functionally, this tube is all about transporting those sperm cells. But inside this tube, there's smooth muscle embedded in the walls. And that helps to facilitate the movement of the sperm cells along this pathway. Now, what activates the smooth muscle? Well, that typically happens during sexual arousal. So when arousal occurs, that sends some nerve impulses to the smooth muscle to start contracting and propelling the sperm cells forward to eventually get down, like we mentioned earlier, prostate, which contains the part of the urethra. And then there was this day in the past when someone thought, if I can stop the sperm cells from going from the testes to the prostatic part of the urethra, we could have men deal with the birth control. And then all the women were cheering in the streets, and the birth control pills and the IUDs and the implants were tossed into the fires as humanity celebrated the development of the procedure known as the vasectomy. Now that's not really how this all went down, but the point is, we gotta stop the sperm cells from getting out, and to do that, we're gonna talk about snipping this tube. Now there are two main approaches to a vasectomy. One is referred to as the conventional vasectomy, and that is when they actually make a 1 centimeter incision into the scrotal tissue. The other is referred to as a no scalpel vasectomy, which kind of self-explanatory, but in this case, they use a puncturing tool to puncture through the scrotal tissue. Now, a lot of people will think, well, what's the main difference there? You still gotta go through the scrotal tissue. And I agree, the end game is still to isolate this vas deferens, but the no scalpel approach tends to be associated with less pain and fewer complications. Both are pretty effective, but
if you have to pick the winner, the no scalpel approach is a little bit better. But once they isolate the vas deferens here, they'll create a loop, and we actually remove a little piece of it. They'll take on average out about 10 to 15 centimeters of that tube out. But let me kind of show you that in a larger little object lesson here with a bigger tube here. So let's imagine this is the scrotal tissue, the glove, the pink glove there, and we've isolated the loop of the vas deferens, and I'm gonna snip here, and I'm gonna snip there, because we're gonna remove a few centimeters there, obviously not to scale, but we've got these two blunt ends here, and before we put the two blunt ends back in the scrotal sac, we're gonna cauterize the inside of the tubes to block them off so no sperm cells can leave the testicular side and go into the side that's gonna eventually make it to the urethra. Now, on top of that, remember, let me show you this. This connective tissue that surrounds the testis and even the tubes here, we've removed a lot of it there. They'll take a little piece of that, like fascial tissue, and they call it a fascial interposition, and put it over the end that essentially would go out through the rest of the body, and they'll stitch it down with some absorbable stitches. And then you've got cauterized ends as well as a blocked end with fascial tissue, and that tends to make these even more effective. So once that has been completed, the person is either stitched or glued. If they were the conventional approach because they made the incision, they'll use sutures or stitches. If they use the no scalpel approach, usually glue is just enough to hold the scrotal skin together. But then we have to talk about aftercare and what to do after the procedure. So men are often advised to wear supportive underwear for about 24 to 48 hours after the procedure to help minimize discomfort. They can also use things like Tylenol and ibuprofen, or even icing the area 3 to 4 times daily, again, just to minimize discomfort. However, they are given very strict coital precautions, or in other words, they are advised to use other methods of contraception for about 3 months after the procedure. And here is why. Yes, we mentioned that the epididymis stores the majority of the sperm cells. However, some of those sperm cells will make it into the vas deferens and can be stored in there for extended period of times, up to 3 months. And so a clinician who did the surgery will often recommend to the patient that they do a seminal analysis 3 months post-procedure to analyze if there's any sperm that has been released, if you will. Now, 80% of men typically have zero sperm cells, but if there is any, they'll do a follow-up seminal analysis to just see if they needed more time to clear the tubing. Now, there was an interesting study that came out that said coital frequency of about 3 times per week tended to clear the area of sperm cells more quickly than any time that's less. So you could maybe think the more coital activity or the more intercourse, the faster you can clear all the residual sperm cells out of that vas deferens. Seems pretty reasonable to me. Now, how effective is a vasectomy? It is the most effective way for male birth control and one of the most just overall types of contraceptive methods, up to 99%+. Nobody wants to say 100%, but pretty close, because there has been some rates of what they call recanalization, or in other words, the tubes reattaching to each other, but that's rare. We're talking about 0.2% of cases. And there's some disagreement and some variability based on the type of procedure that was used. Did they cauterize? Did they use that fascial interposition that we mentioned in this? All those could potentially influence the rate of recanalization or the tubes reattaching to each other. So let's talk pros and cons. Pro is the cost, actually. These aren't that expensive, ranging from anywhere from $300 to $1,000 in the United States. And if you calculate that over time, that actually will end up being less expensive over the lifetime or many, many years of use of, say, like birth control pills or other contraceptive methods. Another pro is that this does not affect blood supply to the testes, nerve supply, again, if these procedures are done correctly, and also does not affect testosterone. So there's no hormonal issues with this type of procedure. So what are the cons associated with this form of contraception? Well, one is the pain and discomfort after the surgical procedure. However, that tends to be fairly short-lived, and most men get back to their routine relatively quickly. The other is surgical complications like infections or hematoma formation. Fortunately, people are getting pretty good at these, and those complications are pretty minimal. Now, the last question we often get with vasectomies is, can this be reversed? Or in other words, can we take this tube and reattach it even though we took a little piece of it out? And the answer is yes, but the success varies depending on the study. I've seen studies that say successful reversal from anywhere from 30 to 50% all the way up to 50 to 70%. What tends to be agreed on, that the longer in between from vasectomy to procedure to try to reverse it, the longer that time goes, the success rate tends to go down a little bit. But that is why when they talk to patients about doing a vasectomy, they really want to make sure this is what you want to do. But if you do change your mind, there still is some hope.
And finally, the most common question we get, what happens to all those sperm cells that are being produced every second of every day, even after the vasectomy has taken place? Are we worried about this? Are we going to get a buildup, a swelling? Do they have to be released? And the answer is no, because as sperm cells get older or age, they start to degenerate. And remember, the sperm cells were stored in that structure called the epididymis that had that tube that we could stretch out or straighten out to 20 feet long. On the inside of that tube, there are some specialized cells lining it, so on the inside wall of the tube. And those specialized cells have these structures called microvilli. Microvilli are important because they increase the surface area so that they can more effectively reabsorb degenerating sperm cells. So as sperm cells are being produced each day, they're also being reabsorbed each day. Now, this wouldn't just apply to a vasectomy. This would also apply to an individual that has gone longer periods of time from intercourse or other activities that release sperm cells. So I also have to apologize profusely to those who have used the excuse that they need intercourse in order to release the sperm cells because of some, you know, detrimental effect that that might have if they're not released. I'm sorry, that's just not true. However, I would argue this. There are plenty of other benefits to intercourse. I don't know, like love, connection, acrobatic exercise. The list goes on and on. As always, thanks for watching, everyone. Please like, subscribe, ring the bell. It helps to support the channel. Also, commenting like crazy helps to support the channel. Let us know what you think of different contraceptive methods and even ideas for future videos. Also, speaking of support, Jeffrey would like me to remind everyone that he is the only one that is allowed to be naked, and everyone must clothe themselves with Institute of Human Anatomy merchandise. We'll put that in the link below, as well as some links to our affiliates with coupon codes for anatomical artwork and awesome mind-blown anatomy merchandise. So until next time, stay safe out there, and we'll see you in the next video.